those pounds. It carves highways through the sea, and I've seen his power unravel battles right in front of me. There's a faith that stands defiant.
There's no power like the mighty name of
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire.
Hallelujah.
The whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing. we're seeking your face right now, Lord. Holy Spirit, I just ask for comforting right now. Just a blanket of comforting to come over us right now. Holy Spirit, settle our minds right now.
Appear. You're looking into my heart.
Coming back to the heart of worship when it's all about you. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday. A triumphal entry my Savior made on a Palm Sunday. Knowing that he was going into God's will for me. I'm sorry if I get choked up. I told some of y'all when I worship, I'm a crier, so you have to deal with it. But even as this week starts, I get on to myself. I don't get mad at myself. I get on to myself because I should be remembering this every single day of my life. That even though he was making his triumphal entry, that soon he was going to be crucified for me, for you. For you, for you, for you. And he thought of me and you and you and you when he took all the sin of the world on his shoulders. And I know I'm probably stealing Pastor's message, but we know what's all about next Sunday. But I think of every stripe, the crown of thorns for every broken thought that I've ever had. Every impure, nasty thought I ever had driven on his head. That way I wouldn't have to carry that burden. They ripped his beard. They shouted at him. And then they pierced his heart in the end. For me. For me. For you. For the guy at the gas station. For the woman at the store. For the lowest life of scum, the thief on the cross. And this thief. And this murderer. And this cheater. And this liar. And this stealer. This thug. This one right here that has the microphone. This one. This one. You know, Pastor started this series, and I can attest to this because we never planned out for Resurrection Sunday next week. And
and worship, the last ship in the series was worship, and it just so happened to fall on Palm Sunday. And I can tell you that it wasn't planned. But I love how God works, because I'm about to get into my message. Do you like that cue? But Palm Sunday, and we get to talk about worship. Amen. Lord Jesus, I thank you, Lord, for a time of just your presence. Lord, forgive me, Lord. Forgive me for anything that I've done, Lord, that has dishonored you, Lord, has disgraced you, Lord, for me being a light into the world, what you've called me to be. Lord, I ask you right now, take me out of the way. If you got to take me out too. I'm good with that. But I ask, Lord, that this isn't my agenda this morning, that it's yours. That if we just all have to just fall on our faces and worship you for the next 5 hours, I'm good with that too. I don't have to say another word. We love you, Jesus, and I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the privilege and opportunity, Lord, to spread your word, your good news, your hope, and our destiny. In Jesus' name, and the church said, amen. I have one page of notes, so this is going to be really short. Nobody believed me. I see why Pastor kept the clock back there. It still says 8:20. So if we got to noon, yeah, man. Whew. Somebody call pizza. It's going to be a long one. If you haven't been participating or a part of the worship class that I've been giving on Wednesday nights or once a month on Tuesdays, when I do it again, I encourage you to be a part of it, because some of the stuff I'm going to touch on, a lot of it has come out of that. I have the privilege and honor to talk to y'all this morning about worship. If I scream, please apologize. I haven't been behind the pulpit on a Sunday morning since, since the last time, which was probably in December. So there's a lot of fire that's built up. Oh, nobody wanted to hear that. We've been going over worship, and a lot of the people that have been a part of it and have been it can attest to this, that it has changed their mindset about worship. That worship isn't about the platform. It's like I just shocked y'all. Worship isn't about me up here. Worship isn't about Jan and Kim up there. Worship is a lifestyle. It's like I just rocked everybody's world. They're like, wait a minute. You mean that I gotta worship, Pastor? That means that I gotta be a part of that? Yeah. Absolutely. So Matthew 21, 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethanage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them, bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what has spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle, riding in on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus instructed them. They brought the donkey and colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowd answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this morning. I thank you, Lord, for your word, Lord, that it sharpens, that is sharper than any two-edged sword, that it pierces right through our hearts this morning, Lord. Lord, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. So worship, we're talking about worship, and I'm just going to jump right in this. As Mama Diane says, Chris, it takes him a minute to get up, and then I start just punching. So here we go. Worship or worship? Worship is giving something, giving value to God. Worship is giving value to God. I'm going to keep saying that. Worship is giving value to God. Amen. We all give value to something in our lives. We all give value to something in our lives. Rather, it's your business, it's your car, it's your cell phone, it's your house, it's your husband, it's your wife, it's your kids. We all give value to something. So what are we giving value to? What are we worshiping? If worshiping is giving value to something, you ever heard the phrase, "I worship the ground she walks on"? Oh, I worship the ground she walks on. I love her so much. I love him so much. I can't say that. That's weird. I love her so much. I worship the ground she walks on. Do you? Shaka is Hebrew for bowing down. That's the Hebrew word for worship. One of the Hebrew words for worship is shaka. It means to bow down. There's a submission when you worship. I'll throw it in the worldly view. If you worship the ground she walks on, you have to submit yourself to the ground she walks on to worship it. It's getting quiet in here. This is going to be tough to swallow. I'm sorry. We need to be careful on what we submit ourselves to. I'm going to say that again for the ones in behind Donnie and them in the sound booth. We need to be careful what we submit ourselves to. We can give submission to the wrong entity or principality. I'm going to rewind that. We can give submission to the wrong entity or principality. Well, how do you know? Well, people give up all the time. People get into submission all the time. Abusive relationships. Depression. Anxiety. What are you submitting yourself to? Fear. You know that fear is the prophecy of the devil? Fear is a prophecy of the devil. I told you this was going to be a tough cookie. We can give submission to the wrong entity or principality over us. We're called to overcome those principalities. So if fear is the prophecy of the devil, then what are you receiving in your life? I don't think I can do it. I don't want to raise my hands. I don't want to bow down before God. It might get weird. Someone might look at me strange. I'm going to stick to worship this morning. Is that okay? Because I could preach for about 7 days on this. I don't know. Pastor may look at me and go, "Oh, he may grin." Somebody may think that I'm a little weird because I raised my hands. I put my face down up here on the altar. I got down in my seat and put down because I need to cry out to God. Does anybody here know what Hosanna means? Save us. Save us. You just got done singing two songs that said, save us. You know, I mentioned in a class not too long ago that I was at a celebration service for one of my children's pastors when I was growing up. And they played a song. And when they did it, I looked at my mom and I could sing everything, every word of that song. She was telling a story on how she saw an angel when she was a little girl. And as a kid, a five-year-old kid, I leaned and I elbowed my mom and I said, from the dryer. And her daughter said, from the dryer. Because I remembered those things. Because I remember what was put in. I remember what I was singing as a kid. So when you got the honky-tonk badonkadonk on, and you're putting that stuff in your head, and you're feeding your children, and we're putting that stuff in your head, you don't think that they're going to remember that? I can prove it. I did it the other night. Dun, 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 dun. Everybody's smiling. Ba-dum-bum-bum-bum. And I just got us kicked off of YouTube. Music is a tool. Music is a tool. So what you're putting in your ear gates may come out your mouth gate. So when we're listening to whatever, hip-hop, rap, the honky-tonk, whatever, and it's teaching us about how I'm fearful of this, or I like to drink all day, or I like to shoot up drugs, do this, slap my old lady, whatever it is, it might come out of you. What are you worshiping? What are you bowing down to? What are you submitting yourself to? These are real things, people. This is real. So before I get into anything else, we got to decide right now. Is God real? Is God real? Yeah. Or are we playing church? Are we churching it up over here and playing church? Oh, God, I'm going to go ahead. Da, 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 da. No, God is real. He's a real God that does real things, that has real breakthroughs that will go through your life. But it depends on what you want to serve, what you want to bow down to, what you're submitting yourself to. What are we worshiping? Proskuneo is the Greek word for worship with three components. Adoration. Prostrate and a kiss towards. Adoration. Praising God for who He is. Because He loves me, I love Him. When you adore someone, you adore them because they love you and you love them. Yeah, yeah. Amen? Just me? I'm the only one that adores my wife? That's right. To prostrate is to lie on one's face. It means to get down. They said to get down, to get on your face, to worship. I asked James one time, I said, what happens, James, if I come in there? Because you're a military man. Well, I can ask the other military men. What happens if I lay down and you're in the Army or whatever service branch you are and I'm laying down on my back or on my face and I'm all spread out? What does that mean? I surrendered. That's a surrender. I'm posturing myself to surrender. What are we posturing ourselves to? And the last meaning is kiss towards. And I'm not going to take away from what Pastor Zach Neese said, but it literally means to kiss towards. And he made an analogy that was beautiful on how his kids, when he drove off, would kiss, blow kisses. Because they know that they want him that much closer. And they're blowing kisses because they love him so much that they want him that much closer. When's the last time you blew kisses at God? When's the last time you prostrated yourself in a position to throw, say, hey, God, I want you this much closer? And like I asked them all before, what happens if half of us got that? What would happen on a Sunday morning if half of us got that? It's contagious. I believe we'd see things that would just blow our minds. I believe things would happen that would just blow our minds, every single one of ours. I think we would be posturing, the church would posture itself to have God show up. Instead of sitting here to be served, we'd be serving God. Oh, I haven't even got there yet. I'm not even in those notes yet. We would be serving God, ministering to God, because you're called to do that. I'll get there in a minute. Worship is love, lordship, and expression. Love, lordship, and expression. Mark 12:30. Love the Lord God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. Your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. I don't think God left anything out there. That's your being. That's your entire being. Love the Lord God with your entire being. With your entire being. Being. God is looking for a deep relationship. He's looking for intimacy with him. Oh, just I agree with that? God is looking for intimacy. The world has perverted intimacy. The world has perverted everything. Let's just get down to it. I mean, I don't have to keep saying it. The world's perverted everything. You can't even watch a commercial. You can't even watch a cartoon. You can't even turn on anything. It used to be bad enough that Wile E. Coyote was chasing the Roadrunner, and that was like, oh my gosh, he's got a cannon. Now it's so much perversion, it's not even funny. There's subliminal messages upon subliminal messages. God is looking for deep relationship. He wants a bride who loves him. Not just loves him, but is deeply in love with him. Who's madly in love with him. You know, it's almost like loving. There's a different kind of love for different kind of people. I love Ricky. I'm not going to use you this time, Justin, because I said it twice and got weird. But I'm not going to kiss Ricky. I may give him a side hug, a hug. I love my kids. I love my mom. But I love my kids different than I love my mom. I love Ricky different than I love my kids and I love my mom. I love my wife different than I love my mom, than I love my kids and I love Ricky. You see what I'm saying? But you love God different than you love all of them. You have a deeper intimacy with God. Because I can promise you something. There are insecurities and things that God knows about you that your wife, your mama, your kids, your friends, yourself in the mirror don't even know. Because there's a deeper intimacy. There's a deeper connection. That's why we get into the hidden place, in the quiet place, and get with God. Because sometimes I need to get with God and say, hey, man, look, God, I'm really struggling with da-da-da-da-da-da-da. There's something going on, God, and only you can fix it. You know I could, because I could talk to you. Because you're full of love, hope, and I know that I could get through this with you. Because there's no judgmental attitude with God. Because he's going to tell me what it is. If it's right or wrong, there's no on the fence. Well, maybe you could do it this way, Chris. It may seem a little bad. He doesn't do that. I don't get God's opinion. I get God's truth.
Come on now. Come on now. Preach that.
I don't need no more opinions. That's the reason I didn't go to the women's conference. 3,000 women, that's a lot of opinions. No, sorry. Bad joke. All the women say, get off the stage. No. Guys, quit laughing. Look at pastor's holding his wife. He's wrong. He's wrong, honey. Don't laugh. Don't laugh too loud. This is being recorded. But God is looking for that intimacy. God is looking for that relationship. Do you have that intimacy? Do you have that relationship? I don't want an answer. That's something you need to ask yourself. That's something that you really need to search your heart. That's something that you really need to ask yourself. Because if you don't, then is God real in your life? Everybody here is old enough. Baby don't care. It's either Santa. It's either God is Santa Claus or God is God. Yeah. Hold her ears. Hold that baby's ears. Because I don't know about you, but God is real in my life. I can go after testimony after testimony, after things that have happened, things that I've seen move, things I've seen run out, things I've seen grow back, things I've seen it. That doesn't make me any better than any of y'all. I still have to fight through flesh. I still have to fight to get to that intimate place with God. I still have to fight to get to that place and that point to where, God, I want to blow kisses at you so much. I'm sitting up here trying to cry because trying not to cry, but so I can get some words out because I'm trying to get as close as I can to you right now. Because I don't care if I fall over dead, then I'm there. John 4:23, yet the time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. That's the kind of love that he's looking for. That's the kind of intimacy God is looking for. It's not coming out of my mouth. It says it right there. You don't believe that? There's a Bible. There's pastor's got 10 of them back there. You can have all of them. No? Okay. Look it up. It's funny. It's. There was an analogy of the man that took his wife's journal, and he was able to read his wife's journal, and he was like, "Man, I'm husband of the year because I figured out what she likes. I got all her secrets." Until she found out and was like, "Oh man." But you know what's fun? You know what's really funny and what's really cool? God gave us a journal of how to love him and how he loves us and how to walk with him. It's right here. You don't know who you are. It's right here. Your identity is right in here. You want to know why you're acting that way and why you can't shake it off? Look through the book. Their journal tells you. It's a journal of telling you who you are, how he loves you, how to get closer with him. How to beat it, how to defeat it, how to kill those giants in your life. It's right here. Or is it holding our coffee cups? Collecting dust on the shelves. Oh, I'll pass it from generation to generation. How many generational Bibles that I've seen that still look like they came off the shelf? They're just dusty. And how many generational Bibles I've seen that looked all scarred up, marked up, tore up, the hems coming off of it because they've been read. That's the kind of Bible I want in my house. You see, the posture of your body reflects the heart towards the King. The posture of your body reflects the heart towards the King. The cross is the posture of God's love towards us. The cross is the posture of God's love towards us. The cross is the posture of God's love towards you. Amen. The posture of your body is your love towards God. What if Jason never kissed you ever again. Ever again. Never held your hand, never told you he loved you, never said anything. That would be a great marriage, wouldn't it? You had a baby, he stayed home. You struggled, you need someone to talk to, he just didn't listen. He just thought, you'll deal with it. He didn't posture himself to listen to her. He's not posturing himself and showing her affection. When you love somebody, you show them affection. When you love somebody, you're posturing your body towards them. You don't just say, kid, get in the car. Kid, get out of school. Daddy, I hurt myself. I'll go find a Band-Aid. You don't. You take care of them. When you go and you have somebody in your life, women, how many want a man that doesn't tell you he loves you? That's embarrassed to hold your hand in public. I didn't think so. Hey, men, how many of y'all want a woman in your life that won't even get in the same car with you? That won't hold your hand? Matt, not, no. So why do you think that God would want that? Why do you think that God wouldn't want you to show your affection to him? Like I said earlier, I'm a crier. When I get into worship, I'm sorry. I almost start bawling. Sometimes my hands are straight up in the air. Sometimes I got to be on my face. It's been a long time. I just told God what I needed to do. But sometimes I have to posture myself to I can feel closer to God to show him, like, hey, I appreciate you. I want to worship you in spirit and truth. I want to be the true worshiper. I want to show you how intimate we are, Lord. I want to be that much closer to you.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Let it be a sweet, sweet. I searched the world and it didn't fill me. A man's empty praise, treasures of... I am free to run.
I put on Garth Brooks. I bet some people start clapping. Put on George Strait. Probably have a hoedown in here. Y'all don't know what that is. After church, I'll let James explain it. What are you worshiping? What are you worshiping? What are you showing your affection to? What are you posturing yourself to do? Some people do. They raise their hands like this. I'm not saying that you have to raise your hand and how you posture yourself to God is right or wrong. I'm saying that you have to. You have to show affection if you're showing affection to God. You have to. It's natural. It's natural. And it's contagious. Worship is contagious. It's contagious. I promise you. I'm sorry. But your kids, when they get older, really older, will want to kiss people because they see you kiss. No, I know. I'm getting no's right now. But like when they're 70. But they see the affection of love. You see where I'm going at? Young people see the affection of love, so they say, hey, I got to have that because it looks like happiness. So when you're in here and you're praising, when you're in here and you're worshiping, when freedom's happening in the place, y'all listen right now, when freedom's happening right now and you're going and there's somebody having a breakthrough, even I'm going, hey, I need some of that. I got to have some of that. Whatever's going on in your life, whatever God's working, God, can you work through me? Because it's contagious. Stephanie, you look like you're really in love with God. Man, I want to be really in love with God. I see breakthroughs come. Man, I want to have a breakthrough. Mama Diane, I see healing. I want healing. Man, I want healing. Well, you don't look sick. I want healing before I even get sick. Why can't my God do that? I just got done saying he's real. Sorry, I don't mean to yell. Yeah, I do. I can't talk about worship without talking about praise. Praise is the expression of our admiration towards God. Jesus is called the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Judah comes from the Hebrew word of praise, yada. Yad means hand. Yad means hand. So yada literally means to praise with upraised hands. Jesus comes from the tribe of Judah. Jesus comes from the tribe of upraised hands. Jesus comes from the tribe of praised upraised hands. Jesus comes from this, and I'm a child of God, so that means I'm some from the same lineage that I... Just three of us. Jesus comes from the tribe of this. I'm throwing my praise on you. That's where Jesus comes. That's where this he comes from, that tribe. Praise is an expression or an approval or admiration of who God is. What's God's like, what God has done and is going to do. An expression. To express means to make known. To praise means to make known. When you praise your kids, you're saying, hey, my kid is the coolest kid. He turned 4. He's cool and he likes trucks. And he tells everybody that I'm his dude. I'm being for real. I'm praising my kid. I'm expressing that. My God is so big. Oh, nobody's getting fired up yet. My God is so big that I'm not also going to see breakthrough in my life. I'm going to see breakthrough in every single one of y'all's lives. I'm going to see healing in every single one of your lives. I'm going to see restored relationships. I'm going to see stuff. I'm going to see breakthroughs. I'm going to see people come in that you're like, man, that guy was nothing but a drunk, but he's in the church right now. I got children that just hate God, but they love him with all their heart now. I see that happening. That's what happens when you give me like 4 months off. Church, make God known. Church, make God known. Youth, make God known. Make him known. Make him known. Make him famous. I'm sorry, Dom, you ain't never gonna be internet famous, but God is. But you're going to be a mighty warrior for God. You're going to be a mighty, mighty man of God. I'm going to see great things. You're going to be so great. I'm going to be on the ground one day crying because you're going to be preaching the word. And it's going to touch me so bad. I'm going to be bawling. I'm going to come up here and repent. I don't know where that came from. Amen. I think we have a hard time because culturally we have an identity crisis. Crisis. We have an identity crisis. We're not raising up a generation of confused and fearful people. Because I rebuke that. We're raising up a generation of priests. Because you're priests. What did he call me? He called me a priest. That's right. You're a priest. Every single one of you is a priest. I have in like bold letters to scream, you're a priest. But I don't want to scare nobody. The baby's being cool right now. And Lori, we can't. We don't have enough towels. Deuteronomy 10:8. Yesterday I was hiding in my ghillie suit. And... Pastor walks up, and my wife ruined it. She was out the door trying to film. She was like this, trying to film. I was going to scare him again. And then his wife comes, and she goes, what? I'm pregnant, Chris. And I'm like, we got towels. That would probably have been a bad thing. It would have been funny. Yeah, that was, oh, man, I'm just thinking of all the things I would have been called. Deuteronomy 10:8. At that time, the Lord set apart the tribe of Levi to carry the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, to stand before the Lord, to minister, to pronounce blessings in his name, as they still do today. As they still do today. There is a duty. A duty. To carry the presence, to minister to God, and to bless the people. That is your priestly duty. You are supposed to be carrying the presence, minister to God, and bless people. Do it, Justin. You are the connection between heaven and earth. When you are born again, you were reborn. You were born from earth, and when you're born again, to do what? To minister. Oh, you mean I'm a minister? That means serve. Wait a minute. Whoa. You said minister. Yeah, nodhead. It means serve. You don't minister to God because you're some holy da-da-da-da. You're ministering to God. You are ministering to God. You are serving God. You are to carry the presence, serve God, and bless the people. Not when they sneeze. Not during the meal, but a blessing. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. That is the priestly blessing. That same week that I had my children's pastor's memorial celebration of life service was my wife's grandparents' memorial service. They died 72 hours between each other at 90-something years old. True love story. Their prayer was the priestly blessing. They're like, here, Chris, read this. And I went, oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. That's the blessing you're supposed to be pouring upon people. That's the blessing, Stephen. Where you're going to be blessed beyond all means, man. Every time you open your mouth, someone's going to get saved. You're going to be a walking sword to the enemy. They're going to say, man, bro, I got to get out of the way, man. You are sharp. You're going to start, go ahead, preach to them. I got to get out the way. You're going to be like 20,000 looms, flashlight kind of light. You are Tony Sachery of the world. That's the kind of blessing. I know your blessing, girl. And I'm going to see it. I'm going to see it. Once you get to that intimate place, I'm going to see that blessing. And we're all going to see it. And your kids are going to be blessed. And your children's children are going to be blessed. And not monetary. Freedom. Freedom of everything that you think that's overtaking you that's not. Because you're a warrior. You're a warrior. The enemy's lying to you, girl, but you're a warrior. And you know you're a warrior. And I'm standing up in battle with you, sister. Those are the kind of blessings. The kind of blessings where Ricky's going to get married and ride off into sunset on a horse. And he's going to kill a real deer. He's going to go to every Bass Pro Shop in America. I'm just joking. But he is. I see the blessings coming in you, man. I see the favor of God pouring into your life. So much that you pour the favor out on other people. I see a giving spirit to where it's even more. You don't even know why. You're like, bro, I don't know. I just have to give you this Lexus. I see that. That's the kind of blessings that you're supposed to be pouring out on people. That's what you're called to do. If you're housing the Holy Spirit, if you're carrying the presence, if you're carrying the presence and you're walking around with it, you can't be mad or bitter. If you do, you need to check yourself before you wreck yourself. Too long, we've let the world influence the church. Too long, we've let the world influence the church and tell us, nah, y'all ain't got no power. Look what COVID did. Look what COVID did. Oh, man. See, the church ain't got no power. Walk in your priestly authority. Walk in what you're called to be. Amen. Look, thank you, Maddie. First Peter 2:5. You are also living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. There is a sacrifice. Worship smells like sacrifice.
Oh, that's good. Come on.
There's a sacrifice. You're going to have to sacrifice yourself to get to the Holy of Holies. I'm sorry, that's the process. You know, the Israelites, they walked around with tents. They had tents. I had this revelation the other day. They walked around with tents, and God said, you know what? Build me a tent. And so they built the tabernacle. But I often wondered, why did God have to have them build him his own tent? Because I wonder what, when they were wandering around in the wilderness, what they were dragging in their own tents. What are you dragging into your tent? What are you bringing along with you? Well, you know, they said, I'll never be nothing. You said, I'm a loser. Not at the Bible, that. You said, I'll be this. I'll just drag this. And then I need this because, you know, my cell phone makes me look pretty. Don't laugh. No, it doesn't. I'm already pretty. What are you dragging in your tent? What are you carrying with you? You need to clear your tent out. If you're housing the presence of God, you need to get out what's unholy in your heart. What are you carrying around in your tent? There's a process to get into the Holy of Holies. There's a process of getting into worship. There's no cheat codes. There's no shortcuts. Up, down, left, right, ABBA. No, that don't work. You can't chop over the fence. You couldn't jump over the fence and get into the courtyard in the tabernacle. 7.5 foot tall. You can't jump over the fence. God took his tabernacle seriously. He takes his worship seriously. God's a serious God. We can't be playing church. We have priestly duties. I'm sure glad he died on the cross and ripped that veil. Because you know what he did with the priests that weren't already clean? They had to drag him out by a rope. First Peter 2, 9 through 10. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. You're God's special possession. You're God's special possession. You're God's special possession. That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. There's a declaration. There's a declaration to step into your calling. You have to be saved. To get your priestly authority, you got to be saved. Revelation 1:6. And has made us to be a kingdom of priests, to serve his God and Father. To him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. There's a transformation. There's a transformation that has to happen. You can't be the same old. I can't be the same old Chris I was. Every day I wake up, I can't be the same old Chris. I have to pick up my cross. I have to repent. I'm just a man. A simple man. A lot of y'all are thinking of that song. Point proven. When you gave your life to Jesus, you didn't change your identity. You stepped into what you were made to be, your real identity. Mark 12:30 says, love the Lord God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. Love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. It's the greatest commandment. Your heart, your affections, your soul, your will, your mind, your thoughts, your strength, your actions, your whole being. So I'm going to read the Palm Sunday verse again. Matthew 21:1-11. I'm telling them, I'm not telling y'all, I'm telling them. They approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go ahead to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle, riding on a donkey and a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus instructed them. They brought the donkey and colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches, palm branches, from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowd that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? The crowd answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. Our Lord comes riding humbly in on a donkey, sitting on cloaks, covering, protection, authority of his disciples. A very large crowd lay their cloaks, covering, protection, and authority on the road. And others spread palm branches, triumph, eternal life, and peace on the road. The crowds went ahead of him. Those that followed shouted, Hosanna, Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Hosanna. The call for deliverance, the plea for salvation, the cry for praise. When's the last time you've cried Hosanna? When's the last time you took off your protection, your authority, and laid it down before your Father? In Luke 19:39-40, some of the Pharisees said to Jesus, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. If I'm laying down what I think is my protection, my cloaks, the things that I think are going to guard me, and I'm laying them down for God, I'm laying them down because I know he's going to come in riding triumphantly. But he came in humbly. Because when he comes back, it's going to be a different sight. When he comes back, it's not going to be on a donkey. When he comes back, you're going to have one or two thoughts. Wow. Or, oh no. They were right. The part I studied about cloaks is kings and rulers, it was a sign of authority. They put their cloaks on. Other people in the wilderness, and they use it as protection. But see, God wants us to build. In Psalms 22:3, God, it says, you are yet enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. We build a throne of praise for God. And sometimes in our lives, we got to figure out what size throne are we building for God? What size throne are we building? Is it big enough for him to sit on? Are we enthroning God or are we enthroning people? Are we enthroning ourselves? There's something that you have to, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I don't enthrone God. Because he enthrones, he inhabits the praises of his people. He inhabits your praises. Are you his people? I just got done saying that you're priests. He's called you to be his priest. He enthrones the praises of his people. What size throne are you building him? Praise isn't just here. Worship isn't just here. There's a lot of us that worship in our cars. There's a lot of us worshiping when we vacuum. I don't vacuum. Take notes. No, I'm just joking. There's a lot of us that praise when we cook. There's a lot of us that praise when we work. But what size throne are you putting up for Jesus? If he inhabits our praises, are we building a throne for him? Are we saying, oh, hold on, Jesus. There's a lot going on right now. So I'm going to close with this. Oh, I got 20 minutes. Never mind. I'm going to close with this. If you're struggling with knowing who you are, who your identity is, if you're struggling on what you're worshiping, if you're struggling on building a throne for Jesus, I'm going to ask you to come up as Lori puts something on. And if you need prayer this morning, I'm going to ask you to come up. Because like I said, there needs to be an intimacy in all of us. We need a closer relationship with God. Your associate pastor worship leader needs to be closer to God. I need to be closer to Jesus every day of my life. This isn't something that, hey, I figured it out, I'm good. This is a lifestyle. There's a lifestyle that comes with this. This is something that I'm striving to get closer and closer and closer and closer and closer, sharper and sharper and sharper. Because I want to be more intimate with God. I want to be that much closer. So if you need prayer, or you need someone, or you just want to come up here and pray by yourself, that's fine too. But don't miss your moment. I know a lot of y'all hear me say that a lot, but tomorrow's not promised. There's a lot of things that this world offers that's not promised, that's not secure or promised. Maybe you're struggling because you don't know. Maybe you're like, well, I want to believe Jesus. I want to believe in God, but I just don't know. I don't even know if I'm really saved. Well, let's get that over with. Let's break through that freedom together. Not for my benefit. Because you're a priest. You're priests. Amen. Peace with God and forgiveness. For all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down at the cross. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you.
y'all stretch your hands towards her.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are
I'll soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine.
Hallelujah, the church said. Pastor Chris, that might have been one of the best sermons I've ever heard about worship. That was dynamic, my brother. Dynamic. You're not going to preach again till September. Amen. Amen. Can I get a few guys to help me up here, please? I'm a note taker. No matter who's speaking, I'm a note taker. And Chris said a few things that I wrote down that I want to leave you with in this. He said the word adore, that part of that means adore. Isn't it funny how we call our kids adorable? Children are adorable. But yet that little baby, Maddie, as beautiful and adorable as she is, she doesn't know how to love her mom and dad. But yet we adore her because she is adorable. God knows how to love you. That's real adorable. That's what really adorable is, when the love is reciprocated and makes you adore more. Amen? And then he said, madly in love. And I showed my wife this. She must really love me because she is mad at me all the time. She is mad at me all the time. So she really loves me. But then he said something. When he done this analogy of the tribe of Judah, don't forget where you came from. How many of y'all heard that? Don't forget where you came from. This is what I came from. I have been grafted into this. This is who I am. I'm not the honky-tonker. I'm not the weed smoker. I'm not the violent-driven, anger-driven, depression-driven. That's not who I am. This is who I am. This is where I come from. Amen? That is who you come from. Because you're my brother and my sister. I don't appreciate that Chris uses my kids for the analogy of the kissing thing. He totally left his kids out of that, but that's fine. Oh, she's not getting married. She's not getting married. Amen. It's a good kid. Careful what we submit to. Careful what we submit to. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. We'll give one to you. Some of y'all know how to give online through Tithely. I have an app on my phone called Bible Hub. Some of y'all may or may not have that. And on Bible Hub, they give you a devotional every day. And this morning, the devotional was this passage of Scripture. And this is 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18. It says, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus." So he says three things right here. This is what Paul writes to the church in Thessalonica. Three things. He says, rejoice, pray, and give. Rejoice, pray, and give. I'm not saying this as a financial giving. It's what you give to that matters. If I don't give time to my wife, it's going to affect the fellowship. We began this whole series with fellowship. We have been called into fellowship with God the Father through Christ Jesus. And then we end this with worship. Psalm says, "Come, let us worship Him, kneeling before Him." When is the last time we really, in our prayer time, in our quiet time, and our alone time, our worship time at home, that we got on our knees and recognized that the king was in the camp? What does that mean?
It means to bow down and bow down more.
To bow down and bow down more. Literally, I cannot get low enough in the presence of God. I can't get low enough. What, man, can't get bowed down enough. But then it says in verses 19, 20, and 21, this is the challenge. Do not quench the Holy Spirit. He says to pray, rejoice, and give. And then he says, do not quench the Holy Spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things and hold fast to what is good. What you heard today was a prophetic word. How do we know that? Because it came from the throne room. And anytime God speaks, it's a prophetic word. He has a word for somebody today. How many of y'all got something out of this message today? The prayer for you before we started was that you would not leave here needing something. You would leave here fulfilled. Did you get fulfilled today? I said, did you get fulfilled today? Amen. Now you have a responsibility. It is to rejoice, to pray without ceasing, and to give. You rejoice in the victories of someone else. You pray even whenever you don't know what to pray about. That's called praying in the Spirit. And you give thanks. You give thanks. You give of your time, your treasure, and your talents. You give. That is what God requires you to do. Do y'all know that? Amen. Are y'all glad? Is it a good thing? Is it a good thing? Those who worship will worship in spirit and in truth. And then Chris used the word worship. If it's worth my time, it's worth my investment. What are you giving your time to? Amen. Everybody got your offerings ready? Everybody ready to give? Father, we thank you, Lord, that your word says you supply seed to the sower. We thank you, Lord, that your word says that you roll back the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing on us that we can't contain. Your word also says, Father, to test you in this, to test you in tithing and offerings, to test you in this. Well, God, we know one thing about you, Father. You've never failed a test. There's never been a test you've been given, God, that you did not make 100 on. So, Father, we thank you, Lord, that you're helping us pass tests every day of our life because you are the God of the 100. You are the God of the 100 today, Lord. So, Father, I make a declaration over my brothers and my sisters today that if they've never gotten a hold of the importance of tithing and giving according to your word, Father, that you would give them a revelation of it. Father, you would give them an understanding, Father, that there is a heavenly blessing awaiting them and a covenant that they've made with you, Father. So, Father, give them that revelation today. Those that can't understand or don't understand the importance of it, give them a revelation today, God. And those that are giving, thank you, God, that you are returning to them 30, 60, 100-fold. They will see their bank accounts full. They will see their children saved. They will see their communities changed, oh God. They will see the outpouring of your love in their life, Father. We thank you for these things. God, teach us, Lord, to apply the word that we heard today, God. Remind us what was for us today, God, and how to apply it to our lives so that we can worship you in spirit and in truth. In the name of Jesus. And the church said, amen. 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 Before you leave, I have a few announcements real quick. Let me get through these announcements real quick. Tuesday is the men's and women's class, our Connect group. This Tuesday. What time? When? 7. Amen. Next Sunday is what? Resurrection Sunday. Hallelujah. So here's what we're going to do. Next Sunday, we're going to do our baptisms next Sunday. So if you want to get baptized, please hear me. Everyone listen to me, please. We're not going to dunk you unless you know what the dunking is. Okay? So here's what I'm going to do. My week is kind of full, but here's what I'm going to do. If you want to get baptized, there's a sign-up sheet out there. I mean, you can come on up too when you're ready. There's a sign-up sheet back there if you want to get baptized. And please fill out if it's you're a child, youth, or an adult, whatever, so we know. And be here Thursday at 7 o'clock while the youth are having their thing. I will teach a class on baptism. You need to understand what you're doing. We don't want to dunk you if you don't know what the water's for. Everybody understand that? That's very, very important. My people suffer because of lack of knowledge. We're not going to put you in unless you know what you're going in for and what you're coming out with. Amen? It's very, very important. Church will provide the meat for next Sunday, right? So we're having our family fun on the grounds. Okay, we'll have Resurrection Sunday. We got a bouncy house for the kids. The youth will have kickball. We'll have something for all ages. Amen. We do this every year, and so come be a part of it. And I'm going to challenge you with something. I look around this room. I was thinking about this as Chris was preaching. Sorry I wasn't listening to you. But I was thinking about something as Chris was preaching. Everyone in this room is here because someone else in this room. Think about that for a minute. You are here. Everyone is here because of someone else that's here. So here's your challenge. Someone else should be here because of you. And I don't mean on Resurrection Sunday. I mean the Sunday after. You understand? We don't go to God twice a year for Easter Sunday and Christmas. Understand that. He died on Sunday so I could live on Monday. Hallelujah. So I challenge you to invite someone to service next Sunday. Let us love on them. Let Jesus love on them. And then challenge them to be here the next Sunday too. Hallelujah. We're having a different bouncy house for the kids this year. It's going to be a little bit different. Who said that? Yep, not for you. We're having a different bouncy house for the kids. This one's going to be a lot bigger, has basketball, a slide on it, all this kind of stuff. Ricky, you're too excited too. We're going to have something for everyone, okay? So please come, be a part of this. We want to encourage you to do that. And it is a potluck. So we're not saying if you don't bring food, you can't eat. Come and eat. But it would be nice if you brought some food with you. You understand what I'm saying? That's the Baptist in us. You got to show up with food. I'm just kidding. I can say that because my daddy was a Baptist pastor. I can say that. Hallelujah. That's just a joke. Don't get mad at me, James. Don't get mad at me. And so I want to end with this one thing. This time of year, every year, we send our kids to youth camp. Every year we send our kids to youth camp. It is getting big enough that we can't send them on our own anymore. I'm going to let James talk about this a little bit more, but this is probably 2/3 of our youth group. Some of them are not even here, right? And so we're sending these kids all the way to Crockett, Texas. And so some of you that have time, we're going to ask you to go and volunteer and be a part of that if you can. James, am I correct in that? We partner with Little Country Church, and we go with them to church camp. And Joseph, their youth leader, has said, hey, there's too many of y'all. Bring some adults. How many of y'all know that's a good problem to have? That's a problem we want to have. We want the children to outnumber the adults. Hallelujah. Because how many of y'all know the more kids we have, the less work we have to do? That's a good child labor law. Amen. Well, God bless y'all. We love y'all. James has got something to share with you. Y'all have a wonderful week.
All right. Hey, so from now until the 15th, we were going to do a car wash, but because of all the rain that happens in April, we're going to be selling barbecue plates. The youth has got tickets for those that are outside of the church. We've got 2 sign-up sheets in the back. There's one for the youth that want to go to camp. The price is $225 per student to go for right now. After April 30th, it goes to $250 per student. The first payment, there's 3 payments of $75 is due. The first payment's due April 30th. So we're going to do fundraiser. The other sign-up sheet that's back there is for those of us in the church that want a barbecue plate. So it's going to be a pulled pork sandwich, potato salad, homemade, and baked beans. If y'all ain't had my pulled pork, it'll make your tongue slap your forehead. So that's what I'm going to be making. So, yeah. So it's $10 a plate. Donation's good. If y'all want a plate, we're going to be dispersing the plates after church the Sunday of the 16th. We're going to be here from 1 to 3 or whenever church is over till 3 o'clock in the afternoon dispersing the plates. So we have these little ticket booklets, too. The youth is going to be running around, and they're going to be selling. So if any of y'all want to